Hello. Today we are going to discuss the major themes of the novel Great Expectations, written by Charles Dickens. As you know, certain themes occur again and again in the novels of Dickens. Helpless and unhappy children, prisons and criminals, cruel and unjust institutions, greed for money and power. These are constantly recurring motifs in the plots of Charles Dickens. They all appear in Great Expectations also and are woven into an interlocking pattern of great subtlety and intensity among the central figures. Some of the most poignant scenes in the book are the opening ones, which describe the atmosphere in which Pip, the hero, grows up. He is introduced as a small bundle of shivers, alone in the graveyard, and this is followed by the terrifying intrusion of the world of active violence and fear as the convict seizes him. Then we see the household at the forge, where he is made to feel guilty and ashamed of his very existence. The Christmas party at which he is rebuked and bullied by his elders, his treatment at the hands of the hypocritical Pumblechook, his introduction to Estella, who calls him coarse and common, etc. Dickens knew that in children there is nothing so finely perceived and so finely felt as injustice, and looking back on his childhood, Pip too knows that truth. Then we have the theme of guilt and imprisonment in the novel. Mingled with this atmosphere of emptiness and desolation is another suggestion which permeates the whole book. It is the suggestion of human guilt and imprisonment. On the marshes is an old gibbet hung with chains. Moored in the river are the prison ships known as the hulks, which held the criminals. In the opening scene, Pip meets the terrifying and terrified convict Magwitch, who is to play so vital a part in his expectations. The leg iron got rid of for the time with the file which Pip steals for the convict from Joe's forge subsequently proves to be the instrument of an attempted murder. Pip's feelings a little later, when he is hoping that the convict will elude the pursuing soldiers, might apply to the whole atmosphere. Then we have the theme of the ruthlessness of law in this novel. Crime and imprisonment are inseparable from the law. The law is the mechanism which society has developed and which it enforces to protect its own interests and to dispense justice. Professedly, the law protects the strong and the weak alike, the gentleman and the commoner, the adult and the child. Dickens, however, gives us the bitterest satire on legal pretensions and on the cruelties inflicted by the powerful upon the helpless, especially upon children. When the convict first appears in the opening scene, he is described as a man who had been soaked in water and smothered in mud and cut by flints and stung by nettles and torn by briars, unquote. Symbolically, this is what society has done to bring Magwitch to this condition. And when we hear his story later, we see how from his earliest childhood he was doomed to become a criminal by poverty, degradation, and the indifference and inhumanity of those who wield authority. When Mr. Jaggers is explaining to Pip how he took the baby Estella from Magwitch's wife and gave her to Miss Havisham for adoption, he states his attitude towards his own action. From Mr. Jagger's description, we learn that children were solemnly tried in criminal courts, imprisoned, whipped, neglected, cast out, qualified in all ways for the hangman. Dickens's final comment on the ruthlessness of the law is the picture in the court as Magwitch is condemned to death. Magwitch is one of the 32 men and women who have been given death sentences. They are herded together, surrounded by legal officials and by a large crowd of people who have come to watch this show. The judge gives a pompous, moralistic speech, singling out the already dying Magwitch as a scourge to society. Dickens here explicitly condemns a public institution which abuses its authority. Dickens is equally resentful of the inhumanity of man to man. The directly personal cruelties of power are best symbolized in Pip's sister, Mrs. Gargery, who wears a coarse apron which she never takes off and which speaks vividly of her negation of all womanly love because the apron bears a pattern of pins and needles on it. Then in the novel we have the theme of the lack of love and sympathy among human beings. A large part of the novel deals with adult suffering and with the states of mind of imprisonment, isolation and lovelessness, of which the marshes, the decayed house and garden, the prisons, the cruelties of the strong towards the weak and helpless are the outward symbols. Pip's infatuation for Estella and the frustration of his passion is only one of the negative elements in the emotional texture of the book. The minds of the main characters are all deformed by the lack of love or by the distortion of love into revenge and emotional greed. All Pip's relationships and moral values continue to be turned upside down repeatedly as he pursues his quest for his identity through the story. Then we have the theme of the corrupting power of money in this novel. Pip's journey through life after he has been introduced to Miss Havisham's house may be called a snob's progress. After meeting Estella, he at once begins to think that her standards are the correct ones and that he and his relatives are coarse and common. The forge now seems to him dirty and he feels ashamed of Joe's ignorance and simplicity. When he is informed by Mr. Jaggers about his great expectations, he never doubts that his benefactor is Miss Havisham and that Estella is part of the design of his fortunes. As he goes out alone on his last evening at home, intending to forget the marshes, he remembers with shame his meeting with the convict, but comforts himself with the thought that it was all a long time ago and that the man was now probably dead. Dickens's account of Pip's life as a gentleman in the city of London and at Hammersmith is a bitter satire on the possession of money without any sense of responsibility for its use. Dickens did realize the great value and importance of money. After all, it is through money that Pip is able to learn the manners of good society, to acquire knowledge of the world, and to get some kind of education under the charge of Mr. Matthew Pocket. But the fact remains that Pip's life in the years of his prosperity is purely parasitic During these years, Pip leads an existence of empty futility, spending his allowance on clothes and pleasure, and leading his friend Herbert into expenditures which he cannot afford. In personality, Pip becomes absorbed into the background of his associates who have a real human fellowship, no intellectual or artistic interests. Thus, there are so many themes interwoven together in this novel. Thank you.